Welcome back. A major announcement on Thursday. Baltimore City State's Attorney Marilyn Mosby said that six police officers were all indicted in the death of Freddie Gray. Some are calling this a victory for a national grassroots movement, a movement sometimes called Black Lives Matter. And as the police killing of unarmed black Americans, like Michael Brown, Eric Garner, and most recently Freddie Gray, all receive significant national media coverage, the movement's message about alleged police brutality has spread from social media into the mainstream media. But you have to wonder if the media, mainly cable news, gets the coverage right, gets the tone right, or at times actually makes it worse. I wanted to talk about this with community organizer and civil rights activist DeRay McKesson, who joins me here now. DeRay, thanks for being here.
It's good to be here.
I know you through Twitter because I feel like you live broadcast protests via your Twitter account. But this time last year, you were just a school administrator in Minneapolis.
Yeah,
you quit your job for this, right?
Yes, I wouldn't say just an administrator, but yes, I was an administrator in Minneapolis.
What provoked you? What moment provoked you? You may disagree with the term full-time protester, but to become a full-time protester.
You know, so I was sitting on my couch on August 16th. Mike Brown got killed on August 9th. And I was sitting there and I was looking on Twitter and I was like, this looks really crazy. So I got in my car, drove 9 hours to St. Louis, didn't know anybody, and I became a protester then. So the reason that I quit was that I wanted to figure out how to like use my skills and talent to fight in this space because you just can't kill people, right? Like all the work that I did in education was important, but kids have to be alive to learn. And that was important to me to do this work.
What's your single biggest objection to the way the movement is treated by the press?
I think that there is a constant pathologizing of black bodies, right? So when black people assemble...
When you say that, what does that mean? Elaborate on that.
Yeah, it's this idea that, like, when black people assemble, it is always criminal. So what you saw in St. Louis is, like,
who's saying that?
It's the way the story is crafted, right? So what you saw in St. Louis is, like, the police were literally attacking protesters. And that wasn't always the narrative that was, like, put out by the mainstream media. What you saw in Baltimore sometimes is... you saw people focusing on sort of the property damage and not actually focusing on what caused the unrest in the first place.
I wonder, are you saying the press should automatically assume the worst about the officers, about the authorities?
I'm saying that there should be balance in the way that the critique is spread, and there isn't. So when I see news articles or when I see broadcasts that present the police narrative as true, so when they say things like, you know...
But it is oftentimes true. The police narrative.
Is it true? I don't know if it was true with Mike Brown. I don't know if it was true with Rakia Boyd. Maybe we differ on what true means.
But aren't you talking about anecdotes as opposed to statistics? Are you saying the majority of statements by police officers in the U.S. are not true? Public statements, press releases, etc.?
What I'm saying is that the police are killing people and that they're saying that it's justified in every case in a way that it just isn't. This is a conversation about state violence. So when I think about Walter Scott, the police gave an account that was untrue, and we would not have known unless there was a video.
Right, that was very clear cut.
Right.
Yeah.
And I would say that there are many other cases. Freddie Gray's another one. With the way the police mobilized to respond to his death was really different until we got a video, right? So we challenge the police narratives because we have reason to challenge, because we've been lied to.
It sounds like you see a double standard of sorts on race. I want to see if you agree with that sentiment. Because what we saw in Waco earlier in the week, the coverage of this biker gang madness, I don't even know what to call it, the coverage of this biker gang madness that happened in Waco, there wasn't the use of the word thug in the media coverage. People like you, I think, spoke out and said there's a double standard as a result. Am I getting that right?
Yeah, I mean, I think that Waco is fascinating, right? So what we didn't see were any dead bodies, right? Nine people were dead. There were 18 people injured, and like the media didn't show any of that spectacle of blood, right? And not that I want to see bloody bodies, but there was a stark difference. And you also saw like the bikers chilling, right? They are in gangs. This is organized crime, and they are just like hanging out at the police line after 9 people are killed. And they're now saying that they might have recovered 1,000 weapons. That context would not happen if those bodies were dark skinned. What was interesting about Waco is that it was all this nuance suddenly, right? Because whiteness gets nuance in the media and blackness doesn't. So you saw with Waco, it was like, oh, these are biker. This is just like a biker group. It's a biker shootout. And you're like, no, they killed 9 people, like shot in the presence of innocent bystanders, 1,000 weapons potentially recovered.
So you're saying the media, I think you're painting with a pretty broad brush, but let me take it to the next step. Are the journalists who are involved in these stories subconsciously racist? What causes the differences you're describing?
So that's a good question. I think one of the dangers when we talk about racism is that we tend to think about racism only at the extremes, right? So it's this idea that like the N-word is the only signifier of racism in America, when that's actually not true. Racism is about how power is used to negatively impact people because of issues of race. Mm-hmm. So what you saw with Waco is that you saw this radical humanization of people who actually committed violent crimes, who really did violent crimes, in a way that you didn't actually see that same humanization with people in Baltimore who were breaking curfew, right? They were treated in ways that like criminalized them in really intense ways, in a way that you didn't see with actual criminals, like people who like violently did things.
Dre, thanks so much for being here.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.